Washington Arch is milestone zero, the starting point of New York City's fabulous Fifth Avenue, the most fashionable, the most expensive strip of real estate in the entire world. In another sense, this famed arch, dedicated in 1895 to commemorate the 100th anniversary of President George Washington's inauguration, is a gateway between the bustling commercial world of Upper Manhattan and a dreamer's nostalgic paradise. For spacious Washington Square, which contains the arch, is literally the front yard of Greenwich Village, cradle place of art in America. Artists come out of their studio hideaways twice each year to put on a rousing street fair with their endeavors, leaving no room for doubt that the widely publicized bohemia of this neighborhood is more than a state of mind. Exhibits contain everything from modest simplicity to bold surrealism. My all-time favorite of the entries is this one, of the arch and a double-decker Fifth Avenue bus. Of course, it could be that I'm a little partial being a double-decker bus myself. That's mainly what I want to talk to you about, me. As I speak, I'm 125 blocks uptown from Washington Square, parked on my company's garage roof of all places, with a whole bunch of other idle double-deckers. And something tells me we're getting the air up here in more ways than one. No one ever comes around to bother with us anymore, except a fellow who makes notes on a pad, with what looks to me like a junk dealer's gleam in his eye. I'm that bus way down there in the shadow. See me? Number 2149. I just know I'm never again going to share the joy of eager sightseers climbing aboard me. The glory of swinging out and around that spacious square, circling happy playgrounds of a generation that will but vaguely, if at all, remember that double-deckers once ran here. Leaving Washington Square behind, drivers almost invariably hustled our customers up Lower Fifth Avenue at breakneck speed, past the old red brick where Mark Twain once lived, and past romantic sidewalk restaurants. The congested blocks of commercialism always set us to crawling soon enough. The first traffic bottleneck was at Madison Square, where Fifth Avenue, 23rd Street, and Broadway cross each other. But sightseeing passengers never minded because it gave them a better chance to see New York's first steel skyscraper, the Flatiron Building, so called because of its triangular shape. From some angles, this building appears no wider than the thickness of its outer walls. Scarcely were my passengers settled back in their seats when I'd have their eyes popping again, this time to get a glimpse of the little church around the corner, famous spiritual sanctuary of theatrical folks. 20 to 30 weddings sometimes pass through this romantic little doorway in a single day. More couples have said their I do's here during the past 100 years than at any other church in the world. Looking up from the hemmed-in churchyard, an unusual view can be had of the 102-story Empire State Building commanding the sky from 5 blocks away. How do I know all this? Listening to passenger chatter for so many years, I've become quite an authority about things along my route. For instance, the Empire State has 6,540 windows with 70 acres of glass, nearly 70 miles of elevator shafts with cars that zoom 80 floors a minute. With a new 222-foot TV transmission tower atop it, this building is now by far the tallest structure on Earth. From its observation promenades, it is possible to see for distances of from 60 to 80 miles on a clear day. To the east is the Chrysler Building, world's second tallest building. Also, the East River and Brooklyn. To the west is the Hudson River and New Jersey. To the south, the tip of Manhattan Island, New York Bay, and the Atlantic Ocean. To the north is Rockefeller Plaza, Central Park, and the Hudson River again. Continuing on uptown, our little memory tour passes through the fashion district of world-famous stores and swank shops. Smell that? Honestly, the aroma of perfume that comes out of these fancy establishments is sometimes so strong, we can't even smell our own exhaust. In the very heart of this frivolous neighborhood stands the city's massive central library, a block-long, $49 million marble structure with some 80 miles of bookshelves. The lions out front that guard the place and some of the other outdoor statuary have become almost as famous as the avenue itself. Uh-oh. Sorry to interrupt our trip, folks, but here comes that man after me. Upstairs, too, where I can't keep an eye on him. But there is very little that the twin towers on our garage roof miss. Judging by the strange shadows they're casting across me, what's in the wind isn't good. If I'd had half the brains of a cement lion, I'd have suspected long ago that my Fifth Avenue days were numbered. Flat tops on our roofs have been steadily on the increase. Flat tops is what our drivers call the new single-deck diesels. Queen Mary's is what we double-deckers have always been called. Our great size, you know. Why, even without motor and passengers, we weigh 26,000 pounds. You've guessed it. It's St. Patrick's Cathedral we're stopping at now, one of the biggest churches in America. It has seats for 4,500 people. St. Patrick's was dedicated in 1879. And designed in 13th century Gothic architecture. Its twin spires are 330 feet tall. Directly across the avenue is, you're right again, Rockefeller Plaza, with its 12.5 acres of skyscrapers, a complete city within a city. Here again, I think of my route as running between two worlds. Now it's the spiritual world on one hand, and the world of man on the other. And yet, the transition between the two isn't as abrupt as stepping from curb to curb. For the long promenade which leads from the avenue into this vast empire of cement and steel is spacious with a divine beauty of flowers along every foot of the way, every season of the year. At the end of the promenade, in a sunken garden area, nearly 1,000 feet below the plaza's tallest tower, the transition becomes suddenly total, with music, laughter, the flow of gaiety everywhere. Get along again. We're traversing Riverside Drive now, beside the Hudson River. Why the sudden switch from Fifth Avenue? Well, swank Upper Fifth is all flat top territory now. Understand, I'm not complaining about this Riverside route. It's got class too. At one place, we pass smack between Riverside Church built by the Rockefellers, with the world's largest carillon and General Grant's $600,000 air-conditioned tomb. As if the breeze from the Hudson isn't enough. As I said, I'm not complaining about Riverside Drive as a route, and with no disrespect intended towards water transportation, we double-deckers have to face the fact we've been pushed to the river. Oh, to have been born a steamship. Well, at least I've been called a Queen Mary. I'd take you on up for a still closer view of the George Washington Bridge. But that man, he's making me so nervous. What's he up to now? My last roll call, no doubt. Ah, what memories those bygone routes unfurl. By the time this documentary is beamed your way, it could even be that every double-decker has disappeared from the New York scene. Of course, I could be mistaken, but... Did you see that? The kiss of death. I'm sure it was. So, farewell, Fifth Avenue. We've come a long way together. Long live your fame. Farewell, Washington Arch. I'd feel honored to have you for my tombstone. Farewell, Empire State Building. Don't streak your windows with tears over me. Farewell, Library Lions. Take good care of that library. Maybe I'll go down in the pages of history. Farewell, Rockefeller Plaza. No flags at half-mast for me, please. Farewell, St. Patrick's Cathedral. This seems like the perfect place to say, Amen.